Well, Jeffrey Epstein is dead from an apparent suicide. And none of us believe that. None of us believe that this guy actually committed suicide. This is the one thing that's bringing the right and the left together. We're all kind of looking at this saying, yeah, no, we call bullshit. It just so happened that the guards weren't making the rounds. It just so happened that there was no video of his cell. It just so happened that his cellmate was transferred out. It just so happened he was taken off suicide watch. It just so happened that all of these things happened. And then it just so happens he kills himself during this time with what would otherwise be no real ability to kill himself in the cell. Apparently they don't give you things and there's no real way to do it. So none of this is making sense to any of us, and all of us are pretty much calling bullshit on this, including myself. Now, because of that, a lot of conspiracy theories are swirling. And I'm going to join in. I'm going to put in my I'm going to put on my tinfoil hat, and I'm going to tell you what I think is everything that is going on with this case and with who potentially offed him. And I realize that this is just a theory. This is like a conspiracy theory, but I'm going to show you what I see. Before I do that, before I walk you through what I'm seeing here and get to the big whodunit, I do want to say that this is absolutely tragic for the victims of Epstein and the other people who were involved in this pedophilia ring. Absolutely tragic. These women, who are considered right now accusers or alleged victims, will not see their day in court, and they will not get their status, their unfortunate status, upgraded from alleged victim to victim. And if they had their day in court and Jeffrey Epstein was actually convicted and sentenced, these women would no longer be alleged or just accusers. They would be victims. And that is something that is so important for a victim, to be able to have that, to be able to say, I'm not just an accuser for money. You know, people accuse them of accusing for all kinds of reasons. And when somebody's actually convicted, when they go to court and they're actually convicted, that stuff largely goes away. And when they're written about, when they're talked about on the news, it's not just alleged. The status gets upgraded. So this is actually very, very tragic for these women who will never get that vindication. It's also very tragic for the other women who have not come forward, who are too afraid to come forward. It's tragic for them as well, that many powerful men are essentially going to get away with this. And that is absolutely tragic for all of us. So that being said, let's go ahead and go down the conspiracy theory road and think about who might have done it. First of all, in order to figure this out, we have to start with the beginning. We have to kind of stick with what do we know, and then we have some questions, and let's try to answer those questions. What we know is Epstein was operating a pedophilia ring. We also know that we don't know how Epstein made his money. People are saying that he made his money through financial planning, or nobody really knows. I mean, people say, well, I think he did this, but nobody has any clear sources or clear examples or known. There's really no way. And that's something that people have been talking about for a while, is that we have no idea where this guy made his money. So you could kind of assume, and we have to do a bit of assuming since we're doing some conspiracy theorizing here. You can assume that maybe he made his money through extortion of these from operating this pedophilia ring. So he was either blackmailing or extorting, or both, and that's how he was getting his cash. Lots and lots of money. We're talking enough to buy a $77 million mansion, and we don't really know how much he has or had, but it was a lot, hundreds of millions of dollars potentially, maybe even $1 billion. We know some of the victims, they've come forward. We also know who they claim some of the perpetrators are. Most of the ones that we know that have been named so far have been politicians, heads of state, people with political influence, okay? These are the things we know. We also know Epstein had an accomplice in recruiting the girls, Ghislaine Maxwell. She's a British socialite, and we know that she was, from according to the victims' testimonies, that she was the one who was recruiting them into this pedophilia ring. We also know Epstein was given a sweetheart deal by Alex Acosta when he was first investigated for these crimes back in 2008. And we know that he's dead. And we know that the circumstances surrounding his death are unbelievable. Okay. These are the things we know. So from there, we've got some questions. The first big question would be, why would Epstein operate this pedophilia ring? What would be his reason? Now, there's a few reasons why he would maybe operate this. So the first is just because it was fun. But that doesn't really seem to make sense, because what we know is we don't know where he got his money. So we have to kind of assume that he probably got his money off of extorting and blackmailing. So it wasn't just for fun. He had a purpose to this thing. So then the question would be, okay, if we can assume, now remember, we have to do a lot of assuming because we're conspiracy theorizing here. If we can assume that he made his money off of extorting or blackmailing these people that he got involved in the pedophilia ring, then you have to ask the question of, did he do the extortion because he was trying to get money? Or was he doing this extortion and blackmail because there was a need or a desire for power and influence to get leverage over these people so that they would make decisions or behave in a certain way that was beneficial to him? Now, let's say it's the first. Let's go down that road for a second. Let's say that he was doing it for the money. Well, that would be a little strange. And the reason why is because the perpetrators that have been identified so far by the victims have been, like I said, politicians and heads of state. Not really people known to have a lot of money. Like, for example, New Mexico Governor Bill Richardson. How much does a governor make? I mean, how much could you possibly extort from a governor? Prince Andrew, Britain's Prince Andrew. It's very difficult to extort money from the monarchy because they actually don't have that much. They get everything paid for because they're kind of tourist attractions for people. But they personally actually don't have gobs and gobs of wealth. They have wealth. The family has wealth, and they're able to distribute that wealth to members of the royal family so that they can go and make appearances and do various things. But it's not like you could really extort $100 million out of Prince Andrew or even $10 million out of the guy. I think it would be very difficult. You've also got former Senator George Mitchell. Again, how much does a senator make? Deceased MIT scientist Marvin Minsky, Alan Dershowitz. You've got modeling agent Jean-Luc Brunel. They also named wealthy financier Glenn Dubin. Also, we know that there are some other connections like Trump to Epstein. We also know that Bill Clinton is connected to Epstein. So when you're looking at this list of people, if you were to operate a pedophilia ring with the intent to extort money from wealthy people, I don't know if this is the list of people you'd come up with. I think you'd probably go after really wealthy people. You'd go after like Richard Branson. You'd go after, you know, like really high level, extremely wealthy people. And you would get them to engage in the pedophilia ring so that you could then extort large sums of money from them. And it wouldn't even matter to them because they have so much money. You just wouldn't go after the New Mexico Governor Bill Richardson, right? So I don't know if we could say that this extortion was for the money. I think instead, when you're looking at this list, and because so many of them are heads of state, I mean, they also said the woman that was naming names, her complete list was New Mexico Governor Bill Richardson, Prince Andrew, Glenn Dubin, the wealthy financier, former Senator George Mitchell, MIT scientist Marvin Minsky, Alan Dershowitz, modeling agent Jean-Luc Brunel, as well as another prince, a foreign president, a well-known prime minister, and the owner of a large hotel chain in France. So some of these are wealthy, like the wealthy financier Glenn Dubin and the large hotel chain owner in France. But otherwise, you know, you're talking about powerful, influential people, a foreign president, a well-known prime minister. You've got a New Mexico Governor Bill Richardson. You've got all these people with influence and power. So I think from there, we could then assume that this ring was set up in order to get these people in their pocket to make decisions. Influence and power is the reason for this. So that makes me think that if Epstein was getting money, gobs and gobs of money from this pedophilia ring, that it likely was not through extorting these individuals for money, that he was doing a job for somebody else, and that somebody else was paying Epstein gobs and gobs of money because that person or group of people value the influence and power that this group of individuals have. Do You understand? So because you could then say, well, no, maybe Epstein wanted to have all these people in his pocket. Maybe he was looking to be the puppet master of all these powerful and influential politicians. But you have to ask then, but why? Epstein wasn't a huge business owner of some mega corporation. And, you know, he wasn't like a telecom guy or a bank guy. He didn't need any of this political influence from these people. It's not like he was trying to get blackmail them so that they would regulate in a way that was favorable to his business or make rules and regulations that was going to help him out or, you know, relax some regulations and things. He personally had no reason to accumulate political influence. Not to mention, all of this political influence is, from the looks of it, French, British, and American. So if you are an American business owner and you're looking for the politicians to be in your pocket so that they'll regulate a certain way that's going to be beneficial to your business, I don't know if you'd be going after a British prince and French, you know, French people. Now, one thing I want to point out, when this woman mentioned a foreign president, not very many nations have a president. Most of them have prime ministers or some other thing. So president is very unique. And the French do have a president. So a foreign president could be the French. The Brazilians also have a president. So maybe, but I think it's a French president. I'm going to lead you why I think that. So it's, you know, Epstein doesn't really need to collect this political influence. So the next question you have to ask is, who would want to collect political influence and who could then pay Epstein gobs and gobs and gobs of money for this? Who would that be? Well, guys, I think it was the Israelis. It's not anti-Semitic to say that Israelis were potentially involved in this. It's not. It's just they have a lot of reason to want to gain this power and influence. And I'm going to explain all of why I think it was the Israelis. And it could have been the Israeli government, like Mossad, very well could have been. Or it could be a group that is very powerful and influential, who has Israel's interests in mind, kind of like AIPAC, you know, the very powerful lobby. I'm not saying they're the ones, and maybe, but I doubt it. Maybe, who knows? But a group that has Israel's interests in mind and would go after this group of individuals. And okay, so let me tell you why I think it was the Israelis. Let's first go back to a couple of dots that we're going to have to connect on this. Ghislaine Maxwell. Who is his accomplice? First of all, Jeffrey Epstein was Jewish. So he would, you know, if he has affinity for Israel, then he maybe would want to do something to benefit Israel. Secondly, his accomplice, Ghislaine Maxwell, the British socialite, her father was accused of being Mossad. For example, if you just go to his Wikipedia page, it says that in 1948, a hint of Maxwell's service to the Israeli state was provided by John Loftus and Mark Ahrens, who described Maxwell's contacts with Czechoslovak anti-Stalinist communist leaders in 1948 as crucial to the Czechoslovak decision to arm Israel in the 1948 Arab-Israeli War. Czechoslovak military assistance was both unique and crucial for the fledging state as it battled for its existence. It was Maxwell's covert help in smuggling aircraft parts into Israel that led to the country having air supremacy during the 1948 War of Independence. Now, her father was Czechoslovakian, Jewish, Czechoslovakian, and very much interested and involved in Israel becoming a nation. He was like a Zionist, maybe, is what you would say. Now, goes on to say, the British Foreign Office suspected that Maxwell was a secret agent of a foreign government, possibly a double agent or triple agent, and a thoroughly bad character and almost certainly financed by Russia. He had known links to the British Secret Intelligence Service, MI6, to the KGB, and to the Israeli Intelligence Service, Mossad. Six serving and former heads of Israeli intelligence services attended Maxwell's funeral in Israel, while Israeli Prime Minister eulogized him and stated, "He has done more for Israel than can today be said." Okay, so the guy, it sounds like the guy was working for Israel, whatnot, right? So his daughter, Ghislaine Maxwell, potentially is also involved and working, and gets around with Epstein and does the recruiting of the girls so that Epstein could then, and the recruiting of these other powerful, influential heads of state and politicians to get them in these compromising situations so that they would have blackmail on them, so that they then would influence the politics of their nations, the United States, France, and the UK, to favor Israel. Okay? Now, let's take a little bit of a deeper look at the players involved. What's interesting is when you look at basically what proof do I have to support that? We can start with the United States. What's interesting is that Bush, the first Bush, H.W. Bush, was actually very much, he was actually not very pro-Israel. He did some things that upset Israel in his policies. It says right here, how lonely little George H.W. Bush changed the U.S.-Israel relationship. Says here that the 41st president beat AIPAC but lost 24% of his Jewish backing after confronting Israel over the settlements. It's a lesson U.S. leaders have since taken to heart. So it's saying that he really was hard on Israel over the settlements, and he wasn't fond of that at all. So interestingly, after Bush comes Clinton, right? And we all know that Clinton has been implicated with Jeffrey Epstein. Now, of course, he's come out saying, no, I just rode on his plane. It was no big deal, right? But you know, it's like we know that Bill Clinton had a thing for younger girls. Hello, Monica Lewinsky. And, you know, hanging out with Epstein doesn't really look good on you, Bill. So it's possible that Bill Clinton was somehow involved. Well, what's interesting is that Bill Clinton drastically changed the policy with Israel. So after Bush, who was being hard on Israel about the Palestinian, about the settlements, Clinton comes along, and here's from the Institute for Policy Studies. He says, it says here, U.S. policy, this was written in 2000, U.S. policy towards Jerusalem, Clinton's shift to the right, says it's not surprising that Jerusalem has become the sticking point in the Israeli-Palestinian peace process. The Israeli refusal to share the city with the Palestinians and the Clinton administration's refusal to push the Israelis to compromise make successful negotiations extremely difficult. It goes on to say the United States has traditionally been one of the most outspoken supporters of strong legal standards as guiding principles of international affairs, yet has often failed to uphold these values when transgressions have involved a close ally or its own perceived military exigencies. I'm sorry, I'm saying that wrong. Still, positions taken by the Clinton administration regarding Jerusalem have surprised even the most cynical observers of U.S. foreign policy for its disregard of such international legal conventions and its departure from the stated positions of its predecessors. Furthermore, such policies have made the United States a most inappropriate mediator at this critical phase of the peace process. So you go from H.W. Bush from pushing back on the Israelis and losing support of AIPAC, losing support of Jewish constituents, because he's saying, look, these settlements are wrong. And then all of a sudden you've got Clinton who shifted to the right, the Democrat who shifted to the right. Interestingly, he was the one implicated with Epstein. We all know Trump has been implicated as well. And look at Trump's relationship and what he's doing when it comes to Israel. He's, very much shifted and been extremely pro-Israel in his policies. So that makes you wonder. And remember, when Trump was hanging out, this is important, when Trump was hanging out with Epstein back in those days, he was a Democrat. Now, the other politicians implicated were also Democrats. New Mexico Governor Bill Richardson, he was the UN ambassador. He was also the energy secretary under Clinton. He was a UN ambassador for a couple of years, and he's implicated. Also, you've got former Senator George Mitchell, who was at one point the Senate Majority Leader. So this is somebody who is also very powerful, also a Democrat from Maine. Now, why would they target Democrats rather than Republicans? Because, now I'm sure there are some Republicans maybe in the mix, but Republicans have been historically much more pro-Israel because a lot of the Christian right wing believes, you know, they read the Bible and they really have an affinity towards Israel and the Jews, and they have this whole thing going on. So they tend to favor Israel quite a bit. It's the Democrats that are maybe a little bit more wishy-washy. And so if you can get them in your pocket, then you've got both sides now, and you're much more secure, right? So that's really interesting. Now, the UK, also Britain, has been a big supporter, very pro-Israel. And so if you can get some of these British people in your pocket, then again, you're going to get a lot more support. Now, France is interesting, and I believe that this foreign president was probably French president. Because what's interesting about the French-Israeli relationship is that it deteriorated after the 60s. So France was actually the largest supplier of arms to Israel until after 1967. And then France kind of took a turn and actually started favoring the Arabs and the Palestinians. And that was really tough and shocking to the Israelis, all the way up until Sarkozy. And in 2000, roughly around that time, now this is around the time that the victims have been saying that they were most used. It was in the late 90s, early 2000s. Interestingly, right around that time, Nicolas Sarkozy, who was the president of France at that time, took a shift towards Israel. So that was much to the delight of Israel. It was different for France at that time. So that's interesting also to kind of, you know, think about. Now, more connections here is, well, I guess one question you would have is, why would Israel do that? I mean, you know, if you're Israel and you're trying to survive, you're trying to keep your nation going, it's very smart of Israel to have the backing of the greatest military in the world, right? So they've got the U.S. backing. But you can only rely, if you're them and you're thinking like them, you're only going to rely on the U.S. being friendly to you for so long. I mean, you could say, yeah, well, we're friends, so they're always going to back us. But you've seen what's happened. You've already seen France kind of turn and say, you know, we've supported you. We've been your greatest arms dealer. But you guys are going crazy over there, and you guys are occupying lands, and you guys are breaking the law. And, you know, we're no longer going to support you. So they've seen allies kind of shift and change. They saw it with George H.W. Bush, the shift and the change. They saw it with France, the shift and the change. So you don't want to rely on just your cozy friendship, right? You've got to get something else. Now, of course, we know that they got AIPAC, and AIPAC has been lobbying our politicians like crazy, and there's a lot there. They grease the politicians' pockets. They lobby. But again, you can't guarantee anything when it comes to lobbying. You can try. It's your best effort, but there's really no guarantee. But there are guarantees if you can blackmail. There's a lot of guarantees if you can blackmail. So this takes us back to Epstein. Now, some of these other people that have been accused, when you look at the list, you've got MIT scientist Marvin Minsky. He's deceased now. But Marvin Minsky, his mother was a big Zionist activist. Alan Dershowitz is very pro-Israel. You've got, so this mix of people, when you look at it, it looks to me really obvious what has happened here. Also, the fact that this guy was offed in a high security prison and that there was just this perfect storm of events, it makes me believe that it was somebody who was really capable, who could get in there, maybe through the ceiling. I don't know. You know, I don't know. I don't know what it looks like. But somebody was able to get in there and do what was necessary to silence this man. Or some people are theorizing he was taken. I don't know, maybe, you know, if we're going to go full on tinfoil, might as well. Hey, maybe the guy was swapped out. I know some people are circulating that online. There's a lot, you know, there's a lot there. I think the guy's dead, but I think that body is his. And I think that somebody definitely did it. The question is who? And I think it was... I'm not going to say it was like Mossad necessarily. It could have been, or it could be a group that has heavy influence and wants, you know, to see Israel continue to survive and for Israel to remain a nation. And the way to do that is through multiple ways. One, like I said, buddy up with the big military. Two, lobby the hell out of the countries that you can. Now, in the United States, you can do that. You can't do that in every country. So you can only go, that can only go so far in certain nations because others don't have the lobbying. And the big one is blackmail. You can always blackmail anybody. And when you look at this list, that's what it looks like to me. So I'm trying to think if I missed anything here. Yes, I did. I missed one big thing. I'm sorry. Here we go. Alex Acosta, when he was the sweetheart deal. So when he was interviewed, now this came from the Daily Beast. The Daily Beast reported that Alexander Acosta cut the sweetheart deal with Epstein because he was intelligence. So the Daily Beast reports, quote, it's the Epstein case. Is the Epstein case going to cause a problem for confirmation hearings? Acosta had been asked. Acosta had explained breezily, apparently, that back in the day, he'd had just one meeting on the Epstein case. He'd cut the non-prosecution deal with one of Epstein's attorneys because he had been told to back off, that Epstein was above his pay grade. I was told Epstein belonged to intelligence and to leave it alone. He told his interviewers in the Trump transition, who evidently thought that was a sufficient answer and went ahead and hired Acosta. So Acosta said, well, I was told he was intelligence. Now, some people are saying that means he was CIA, but intelligence doesn't necessarily mean CIA. There's plenty of intelligence agencies for other nations as well. But he could have been. He could have been a double agent, right? Apparently Ghislaine Maxwell's father was accused of being a triple agent. Maybe it's possible that Epstein was a double agent working for both the Israeli government and also maybe for intelligence. Maybe he was just working for the CIA to try to kind of crack down on maybe what was, the foreign influence on our government. I don't know. But that's certainly another implication that this whole thing, the ring and the players involved, that it was all because of power and influence. And then you have to ask for why. And I think to me, it's pretty clear. Now, that is my big conspiracy theory in my tinfoil hat. I will have to remove this video after like a week or so. So I'm just going to leave it up and let you watch it. And you can give me your conspiracy theories down below as well. It's going to be interesting how this case unfolds and what we end up learning and what we, and you know, how things play out. But I will be, and it'll become clear why I removed this video maybe later on in the year, but I'm just going to let you know that that's going to happen as well as some other videos. So don't be alarmed when that happens, because I know many of you get alarmed and you say, oh my gosh, YouTube took this down or the forces that be took this down. So I'm letting you know right now that I'm putting this out there. I do have to take this down for reasons that will become clear to you in the future. And I'm also going to be doing that to a few other videos as well. I can put them back up later on in the future, but that's what's got to happen. So this was fun. And comment down below, share with me your theories. Again, saying this stuff about Israel does not make you anti-Semitic at all. Israel is a foreign country, just like Russia is a foreign country, and they have their own interests and they do their own things. And this very well could be one of those things. Okay. All right. Well, thanks for watching. If you'd like to support this show, you can. The links are down below, my Patreon and my PayPal, and I'll see you guys again soon.